Good morning. What a beautiful fall day. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. After all that rain we had, this is just wonderful. We're just moving into fall, my favorite time of year. So we want to welcome you to Jones Memorial. We want to welcome those who are joining us virtually. Please remember that those of us who are in the building to continue to wear your masks. And I want to thank you for your generosity, those who came out and helped with the Eastridge celebration yesterday. I'm sure it was a huge success, and the church appreciates those who came and helped. The barbecue this year, of course, we didn't get to have that, but we are still collecting funds to do the coats for the Eastridge kids. I have to share a story with you. This has been several years ago. And as you know, on the annual, we fill buckets, cleaning buckets for Zimbabwe. And we use the big, you know, I think they're 5 gallon, like paint buckets. And so one of our mission team went out to collect these buckets that a company was going to give to us. And when the lady brought them out the back, and this person, our mission team, identified herself from Jones Memorial, the lady began to cry. And she said, "Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to upset you." And she said, no, you have to understand, my daughter, I'm a single parent on a very tight income, and my daughter received one of your coats. She said, I wouldn't have been able to buy her one. She said, you don't know what a blessing that is. We get letters and calls and all kinds of feedback from this that you may not always hear, but please know that these parents, these children are very grateful for the coats they get from us. And these schools, we've done it so long, they just know it's coming. So thank you for your generosity. If you may give that through your regular tithes and offerings. If you give, e-give, it's just all, you can denote it for the coats. If it's through check, please write a separate check because it does go into a separate account. So, but thank you for your generosity. And that in all that you do here at Jones. It's through your generosity and through your giving that we minister to this community, that we are the hands and feet of Jesus. So thank you so much. We want to remind you that we are meeting on Wednesday nights. You may come at 5:45 for our picnic in the parking lot, which is a great time of fellowship. Please make your dinner reservations by Monday noon so that our cook will know how much food to fix. If you would like to just come and do Bible study with us, that starts at 6:30. Every age group has a place they go and they gather with their age group. Beyond the young adult families, the older ones of us, we meet here in the sanctuary with Pastor Clair. We're doing a great study on the hard things that Jesus said, and we're really thinking through some of these things. So please join us on Wednesday night. Now, if you will stand with me, and we'll say our call to worship. The world outside worries us. Christ calls us to the quieter center, to a quiet center. We come to remember how to trust our Creator. Please remain standing while we sing.
Standing on the promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages let his praises sing. Glory in the highest, I will shout and sing. Standing on the promises of God, standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior, standing, standing. I'm standing on the promises of God, standing.
Good morning, Jones Kids. We are so glad to have you with us today in worship. You know, sometimes I'll sit outside and I love hearing the birds singing and flying around, watching them. It is so much fun. You know what's amazing to watch is they're not flying around worried about where they're going to find their next meal or what clothes they're going to wear. They just trust that all of those things will be provided. And you know what? God loves us so much. Like he created the birds and he takes care of them, he's going to take care of us too. He doesn't want us to be weighed down with worry. He wants us to be happy and to be filled with his joy and to soar in his presence. So this week, as you go out and look around this beautiful creation, remember that he created these birds and he takes care of them. He loves them and he loves you so much more, and he's going to take care of you too. Now this week, we're building a birdhouse in family worship. And if you would like to have one, make sure to pick up your kit in the Narthex. See y'all next week. Bye!
Please join with me in prayer. Gracious God, thank you so much for loving us. We thank you for this beautiful fall day. And our hearts just sing out to you. We're grateful for all that you have done for us. We're grateful that you brought us to this house today to worship you. Thank you, Father, for the many blessings in our lives. Father, may we always truly be grateful. Forgive us when we forget. Forgive us when we're selfish. And forgive us when we don't share with others and we don't see your blessings. Father God, you're more than enough for all that we need. And so, Father, we lift up our sick and our shut-ins right now, Lord. We ask you to minister to their hearts, minister to them physically and spiritually and emotionally. You be their source of care. You be their source of strength, Father. And help us to share and reach out with that same love to let them know that we love them and they are not forgotten. Father God, we thank you so much for the provisions you give this church. We thank you for the generosity of the people who give so that we can be the hands and feet of Jesus, that we can show your love to this community. Father, help us see the need. Help us to feel the need. And help us to always seek you as our source for that need. Father God, we thank you for your son Jesus. We thank you that you gave him to us so that we could have a relationship with you. May we always be grateful for that. And Father God, as he taught us to pray, so we pray now. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
The gentleman who wrote the words to this song had some unhappy times. Well, the title of the sermon today is Don't Worry, Be Happy. So I tried to find a song that would match that. But I figured out this is not really the opposite of that sermon. Lawrence Chewing and his wife lost two babies at birth. And then when she got pregnant for the third time, boy, they were both just as nervous as they could be, and it was terrible, and anxiety was tremendous. But the baby was born. It was healthy. It was beautiful. Everything was just wonderful. They were happy. And he went home and wrote the words to this song, and Ray Bolts helped him put it to music. And it kind of goes along with what's happened to a lot of us, most of us, in the last few years.
It's been a tumultuous time. And if we count ourselves as ships out on the lost sea, the only thing to hold us together is that anchor. And that anchor for us is the promise that Jesus will take us home if we only let him and we only open and acknowledge that we think and we know and we believe that he is our Savior. And this is a song about tumultuous, about all the things that happen in life, if you're the ship, and then that anchor that holds us together. Through the long dark night, out on the open sea, by faith alone, sight unknown, and yet his eyes were watching me. The anchor holds, though the ship is battered. The anchor holds, though the sails are torn. I have fallen on my knees as I face the raging sea. The anchor holds in spite of the storm. I've had dreams. I've even held them in my hand. But I never knew they could slip right through like they were only grains of sand. The anchor holds, though the ship is battered. The anchor holds, though the sails are torn. I have fallen on my knees as I face the raging sea. The anchor holds in spite of the storm. I have been young, but I am older now, and there has been beauty these eyes have seen. But it was in the night I faced the storms of my life. That's when God proved his love for me. anchor hold. Though the ship is battered, the anchor holds. Though the sails are torn, I have fallen on my knees as I face the raging sea. The anchor in spite of the storm. Yes, I have fallen on my knees as I face the raging sea. The anchor holds in spite of the storm.
Sometimes you don't need a sermon, do you? Thank you, Danny. Appreciate you sharing. I think what that song acknowledges and what Danny shared with us and what we're going to be spending a little bit of time with today is the fact that Jesus says to us, don't worry, and still we worry, right? It still happens. There's no way to avoid it. We deal with tough things in our lives. And so what we're going to be looking at this morning is the rest of that passage, just right after Jesus says, don't worry. We're going to be thinking about how do we stay connected? How do we keep that line to the anchor? So that when worries and anxieties are very real, it does not consume us. So let's hear this morning as we continue in Jesus' Sermon on the Mount, this passage from this very middle part of the sermon, very much a part of the heart of this sermon. It's a passage that probably many of you are familiar with. If you haven't heard Jesus say these words, you might have heard the message in one way or another through song or otherwise. So this is Matthew chapter 6, beginning in verse 25. Jesus says, therefore, I say to you, don't worry about your life, what you'll eat or what you'll drink, or about your body, what you'll wear. Isn't life more than food and the body more than clothes? Look at the birds in the sky. They don't sow seed or harvest grain or gather crops into barns. Yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Aren't you worth much more than they are? Who among you, by worrying, can add a single moment to your life? And why do you worry about clothes? Notice how the lilies in the field grow. They don't wear themselves out with work, and they don't spin cloth. But I say to you that even Solomon, in all of his splendor, wasn't dressed like one of these. If God dresses grass in the field so beautifully, even though it's alive today and tomorrow it's thrown into the furnace, won't God do much more for you, you people of weak faith? Therefore, don't worry and say, what are we going to eat, or what are we going to drink, or what are we going to wear? Gentiles long for these things. Your heavenly Father knows that you need them. Instead, desire first and foremost God's kingdom and God's righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, stop worrying about tomorrow, because tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. So this, as I mentioned, it may be a very familiar passage to some of us. If you're not so familiar with the passage, you might have heard the song that matches the sermon title, "Don't Worry, Be Happy." We know the message, don't we? There's cliches about all of this. We get the idea. And yet, have you ever noticed that Jesus isn't just suggesting you shouldn't worry or cautioning that worrying adds years to your life? Jesus is actually commanding, don't worry. Don't worry about your life, what you'll eat or what you'll drink, or about your body, what you'll wear. And we think to ourselves, oh, that's the least of my worries. You know, we are fortunate, I think, in that most of us don't spend a lot of time worrying about where our next meal will come from, or if we have enough layers to keep us warm in the winter months. We need to recognize, though, that for far too many of concerns cause daily worry. We also need to acknowledge that no matter our circumstances, every single person worries about something sometimes, whether it's concerning basic needs or frivolous wants or things that are outside of our control. You know, people in Louisiana right now, they're trying to pick up the pieces following Hurricane Ida. They worry about how they will ever recover from this mess. We wonder about the next trip to the grocery store. You know, maybe that used to be just, do we have enough this week to pay for what's in our cart? But now, after this week, there's a new level of concern and worry there, isn't there? Folks down at the community kitchen, they stand in line every afternoon hoping to get into the overnight shelter, and they worry about having to spend the night out in the harsh elements. Closer to home, we have some worries about our health, maybe our sanity. We wonder when this pandemic will ever end. I worry about the future of our earth. Will there even be an inhabitable earth by the time Owen is my age? You might worry about how your grandchildren are doing in school or how you will care for your aging parents. We're forced to face some fears, our fears, on a regular basis. And then there's all this stuff that we hear about on the news. Wars, shootings, plane crashes, terrorist attacks, natural disasters, one after another, day after day after day. These are the things that worry us. We wonder when our deepest fears might become a reality. When is the suicide bomber going to step into my husband's favorite coffee shop? What if the next fatal car accident is my mother? When will the earthquake strike here? These are the things that make us anxious. And I don't want to downplay the significance of these realities that we face. Whether it is concern for basic necessities like food or clothing or shelter, or worry about attacks or disasters, there really are legitimate anxieties in this life. So with all of these truly reasonable worries, how can Jesus possibly command us, say so emphatically to us, do not worry? I mean, if you're like me, you might look at this passage and you think to yourself, oh, how nice. Cute birds and pretty flowers. But does Jesus really expect me not to worry? Not to worry about making sure that my family is fed and provided for? Not to worry about the health and well-being of the people around me? How could Jesus possibly think that we could live life not worrying? But we have to remember, you know, Jesus knows about worry. Even though he's God's son, he is also human, just like us, with all the same experiences and feelings, and yet without sin. And I can't help but imagine that from time to time, Jesus, you know, was going from one place to another, maybe walking among the crowds, and his stomach started grumbling, you know, and he's wondering, worrying about where his next meal's going to come from. He might have worried, even if just a little bit. So I don't think it's really so much that Jesus is telling us, commanding us to live without worry. I think it's more that he's cautioning us not to allow ourselves to be consumed by worry. So just think for a minute about what consumes you. What takes up your time and your energy in life? You know, if it's your work, then you spend a lot of time and energy on your work. If it's your family, then you're focusing all your efforts on your spouse and your children. And in the same way, if we are consumed by worry, that really drains our energy, doesn't it? Constant worry saps us of life, and yet here we are, seeking life. And the source of life is who? Christ. And here he is, Jesus, the Lord of life, saying to us, don't worry, because when you are consumed with worry, you will lose life. So the point of this series, as we dive into the Sermon on the Mount, is to be thinking about what Jesus teaches us here, about laying for ourselves a firm foundation in Christ and following him with our whole lives. And so we have here in the middle of this sermon, this command from Jesus, do not worry. And yet we know there are things that we almost have to worry about or we would die. I mean, think about a baby. He has no life experience. He doesn't know right from wrong. He doesn't know dangerous from safe. And so if someone weren't keeping an eye on him, I've got to find that sweet. If someone weren't keeping an eye on him all the time, he'd crawl off the bed. He'd roll off the changing table. He'd chew on electrical cords. You know, any number of totally other, you know, kind of seemingly dumb things. But they could result in significant harm, right? So we have to live with at least some sense of caution. We have to acknowledge there are things that happen in our lives or around us that are going to cause us to worry, and I don't think Jesus denies that. And so what I think we need to hear in Jesus' command is that we are not to be consumed by worry. So how do we do that? How do we keep ourselves from drowning in worry? How do we keep ourselves from being overwhelmed by the things that could cause us worry or even do cause us worry? And Jesus helps us with that here in the Sermon on the Mount too. Listen again near the end of this passage that we heard earlier. Jesus says, instead, desire first and foremost God's kingdom and God's righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Instead of being consumed by worry, Jesus tells us, be consumed by God. Instead of drowning in fear and anxiety, Jesus says, desire first and foremost God's kingdom and God's righteousness. The antidote to worry is not no worry. It's not do not worry so much as it is focus on the good news. Draw that line to the anchor that will hold despite all the battering that's going on around us. We can allow our energy to be consumed by worry, or we can spend our energy pursuing the God of life. You know, God loves us. God loves us so much, and God wants good things for all of us, for all of creation. And at the same time, God has called us to serve, to share with others the love that God has shared with us, to offer food to the hungry and healing to the sick. Christ instructs his followers to continue his work in the world, even after he is gone, to be his hands and his feet. So if we're focused on those things, there's going to be less time for worry, isn't there? It's harder for worry to consume us. But it even goes beyond that. When we strive after God's kingdom and God's righteousness, we can't help but be aware of God's presence and God's work in our lives. We can't help but notice the good work that God is doing all around us. Then it's not worry that fills us, is it? But happiness and gratitude and joy and peace. You know, a few years ago, when I was serving a different church, there was a parishioner. One Sunday morning, she came and she asked for prayer for a younger acquaintance of hers. The woman that she was seeking prayer for was just an 18-year-old that had battled cancer once in her life, and it had gone into remission, but it came back. And, you know, I think we all know that when cancer recurs, it always seems to come back even worse with a vengeance. And so with the second cancer diagnosis, it was stage 4 leukemia. And at the time that the church member brought this woman before us and asked that we would be praying for her, she was in ICU, she was on a ventilator, her kidneys were shutting down. The doctors had shared the devastating news that there was nothing more they could do. Now, you know, if that's not a reason to worry, I don't know what is. And so, you know, sort of the goodbyes began, and one of the people that came in to see the woman and to pray with her, among many other things, she prayed that God's glory would be shown through God's work in this woman's life. Well, the next Sunday, just 1 week after this prayer request had been shared with us, we were receiving the good news that the young woman's kidneys were functioning again. She was off the ventilator. A week after that, she was back home. Now, if that's not good news, I don't know what is. And I know that outcomes are not always like that. They are not always what we want. They are not always what we pray for. But when we trust in God, no matter what, he will help us through all things. When we praise God in the good times and the bad, then we experience life, not the things that sap us of life. And here's the thing. If we are looking for all the good things that God is doing around us, small and large, then it really is a lot harder to get lost in worry. If we're making ourselves available to serve God and to serve others so that our neighbors don't have to worry, then we won't have as much time to be anxious even when there is plenty to keep us worried and anxious, we have to take time to be grateful for all that is good. And we need to celebrate God's blessings. We need to give thanks for the life-giving work of Christ Jesus in our lives. I truly believe that if we seek first God's kingdom and God's righteousness, then we can come to know the peace and the life that is in Christ. So I want us to do something this morning as we close our time together. In a moment, we're going to bow for prayer, which is not unusual. But instead of me just praying through that, I'll get us started, and then we'll pray in silence. Because I want each of us to let go of the very specific things that are causing us anxiety right now. And I want us to turn these things over to God and ask God to help us walk through this. And then, once we've done that, I want each of us to give thanks to God in Christ Jesus. Again, very specifically, for the many blessings and good things in our lives. So let's take this time to let go of your anxieties and your worries. Let's take this time to give thanks to God. Let's take this time to let God's peace and life fill us. Will you bow with me today? Loving, life-giving God, we come before you today as a people who recognize that a lot of our energy is consumed by worry and anxiety. So now in this moment, Lord, we turn these things to you. Lord, I thank you that you help us carry these burdens, that you walk with us in every moment. And we recognize, Lord, that there are so many wonderful ways that you bless us every day. And so we celebrate those things with you now in gratitude. Christ, you are Lord of our lives. We thank you for your presence with us in all things. And we pray that as you walk with us, you would be for us a source of strength in difficult times. And that we might indeed be able to turn over to you in every moment all that holds us back in worry and anxiety, and to experience in you fullness of life, in peace and joy and love every single day. Amen. Now I invite you to stand and let us sing together the Spirit song. May you be filled with the Spirit of God. May you experience life and peace and joy and love in Christ Jesus our Savior. And may you share that good news with all that you meet. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.